So before like anything, I just want to say thank you all for being here. You know, I appreciate it. I, like all of you, I'm a student. You know, I'm not here at Dean. I'm kind of at Holyoke High, you know, I might like move all that. But, you know, I really wanted to really give an introduction to a great man who's coming to speak today. I had a chance to meet him, you know, earlier on this summer. He was a really great guy. This is a man of integrity. He drove, you know, a few hours down to Boston just to come talk to you. You know, and he's not, you know, some, you know, adult figure trying to talk down to y'all, telling you to do this, you know, telling you to go to school and do all this, you know, don't do drugs. I'm going to let you know everything he's telling you is coming from the heart. You know, I've talked to this guy, had one-on-one conversations, and he's from the same streets that we are. You know, not Holyoke, but he's from Boston. You know, and we deal with the same things. You know, I've been out there, and I've seen what's out there. And the same issues we got going on here is the same things they got going on out there. So he knows every single thing that, you know, not every experience y'all got, but he knows what y'all deal with, roughly. He knows, you know, the exact things that poison our streets, the drugs, the gangs, etc. So he's been there, he's done that, and I met this guy, and he's just, you know, he's a great guy. I'm going to just keep it a buck with you. You know, I wouldn't, you know, if I had to choose any speaker, you know, anyone in the world, I would probably pick this guy to come down here. You know, he's, you know, just, you know, I like to sit here and, like, give this guy a crazy introduction, but I can't. Like the only way that could happen is if, like, I really let him do it himself. Like, his story himself is just gonna, like, blow you away. So, without further ado, I'd like to really give you Will Morales.
Hey, thanks, Jay. First thing, I'm Will Morales, and I am the commissioner of Boston Centers of Youth and Families, so I work for the mayor of Boston. I'm actually one of only two Latinos who are in leadership roles within the city of Boston. And I'm very fortunate that the mayor happens to be a good personal friend and that he picked me for this position because he actually sought me out for this job, okay? But if I talk to you a little bit about my professional career is, I spent about 14 years working with the YMCAs, working my way all the way up from a youth worker up to an executive director up to a senior position within the Ys. I've been a senior vice president at a college, at Wheelock College, where I founded an office called the Office of Community Partnerships and Programs, and I worked 6 years in the ski industry, all right, in snow sports and winter sports. And being a Puerto Rican in winter sports, trust me, I used to drive them crazy because they didn't understand what I was doing there, all right? So I enjoyed that stuff. And in between, I was a cast member of a television show, and I've done some work internationally too as well. I've been to Ireland to do youth work, I've done it in Colombia. And I've also done it in Brazil as well. But if I tell you my story and where it began, it actually began in Comerío, Puerto Rico. All right? Where I was born in the same house that my grandmother was born and my mother was born. Okay? And I would be the last one to do so. But I was born to teen parents, a father who was a heroin addicted individual, and a mom. The only thing she wanted to do and go in life was to be a mother and love her children. But unfortunately, my father's drug addiction made life a little bit hard. And by the time I was 7 years old, I was fixing my father's heroin stash. And I would go buy my father's stash because that was the expectation that was put on me. At the age of 8, my Uncle Chucho was killed in front of me. And I can still remember hearing the gunshot and parts of his brain hit my face. And that traumatic experience forced my mother to leave where we lived in Brooklyn, New York, to come to Boston, Massachusetts. She emancipated herself from that relationship because what she was trying to do was save her two sons and try to give them a better life. But unfortunately, my mom didn't speak that much English. She didn't have that much skills. She didn't understand how to run a budget or how to run a household. She didn't understand it's not only just paying the rent, it's also paying the heat. You know, we had plenty of nights and where while we ate, was basically rice with eggs, because we couldn't afford the meat. And that's how tough it was for us. By the time I was 12, my mother sat down and talked to me and my brother and said, Papi, mommy has to go to a shelter. And I'm gonna have to put you guys in foster care. You know, and being a Latino male and that machismo, and being 12, my family's breaking up because we don't have no money. I knew where to find the money. Corner of School Street in Washington, Anderson Square in Roxbury. Neighborhood I grew up in. And see, I grew up during a time where crack can change your financial reality really quick. And I dove into that world. And when I dove into that world, all my options ceased. By the time I was 14, I was a bilingual student in the New York City system. But when I came to Boston, the lack of translation services, they put me in a regular program here. So I suffered academically. And at 14, I was confronted by Ms. Yearwood, a teacher who was from Barbados. And she told me, child, I know you know not to read. And it was correct. I did not know how to read. The sad thing is I didn't know how to read and write in Spanish either. So at 14, I walked away from high school. And I always tell people that I committed the biggest criminal act in my life, because what I did, as soon as I walked away from my education, then that's it. My fate was sealed on the streets. There wasn't going to be any more options for me. By the time I was 15, I was stabbed twice. 16, I was shot. And by the time I was 17, I was deemed such a threat to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts that I was given a 10-year mandatory sentence to state prison. And that's where I went off to grow up. There I was, entering an institution with the rest of the no-goods, still trying to figure out my manhood. And I was content. I was just like any other boy of color who went to prison, who ran the game on the streets. If I do these 10 years, when I get back out, I'm going to have mad respect for my heads and my block. Because everything was about my block. I was willing to die for my block. I was willing to rep my block. But at the end, all I got was a cell block. And there I was, content. 2.5 years into my sentence, I'm chilling one night, and I'm watching Seinfeld, some corny show. And I hear a news bulletin that a young man opened fire on 2 Boston police officers with a 12-gauge Mossberg shotgun at the corner of School Street in Washington. I remember jumping off my bed, and I glorified like the second coming of Jesus Christ. I thought I was Pentecostal. I was speaking in tongues. That's how happy I was. I was bragging and telling everybody, turn on the TV and see what's going on. Check it out. Look what my boys are doing. Because I thought I needed that event to continue to try to establish my little reputation within the four walls. And at this time, I'm an NCCI gardener. I'm not even that far from here. I went to bed with a Kool-Aid smile, thinking I was the baddest thing in the world. Thinking about the next day, I'm going to get praises. Because you see, and you're known for shooting cops, you're like a god in prison. And if you run with a crew that's known for doing that, like the crew that I ran with, because we were known as a street gang that was not known for attacking other gang members. We attacked police officers. So they really didn't like us. But at 4 o'clock in the morning, 2 correctional officers come to my cell. I thought they were gonna run a goon squad. And it was a goon squad when they actually come in to try to get contraband out of you. And they just said, Morales, you need to come with us. You need to come to the office, and you need to take a call. So I'm thinking, cool, I'll just go and take the call. What could it be? I'm not thinking that what I saw the night before had to do anything with me, because they didn't mention any names. All they said is the assailant opened fire on 2 police officers. So when I picked up the phone, I could hear a house in pain. I could hear people crying, but most importantly, I could hear my mother's distinct screech, her pitch. Because you see, that was the same cry that she had when I got shot, and she was crying in the hallway outside the hospital. And I could recognize it. And when somebody was on the phone trying to find her, and they found her and they said, your son Willie's on the phone, I could hear my mother doing this, and she took a deep breath. And she said to me in Spanish, yo esperaba esto de ti. Yo esperaba esto de ti. She expected that from me. And I'm like, what's going on? She hung up the phone. As soon as she hung up the phone, I had to have one of the guards gently touch me in the elbow and tell me, sorry to hear about your brother. He got into a shootout last night with the 2 police officers. He was my only brother. I don't got no more sisters. I don't got nobody else. He was the baby. He was Junior. He was the total opposite of me. The one who could read and write. The one who played 5 musical instruments and nobody taught him how to play them. All right? The one who was in middle school, went to one of the better middle schools in the Boston public school system, and then on top of it was the chess champion for the city and represented the city of Boston against suburban schools. Repping and doing it correctly. He was the one in our family that we put all our hopes that he was going to graduate from high school. Because we didn't think he was going to make it to college, but he was going to graduate from high school. But something happened, and when I got locked up, the game became real for him too. and he was trying to follow his big brother's footsteps. And unfortunately, I don't know why he chose that he can go toe-to-toe with two police officers. I had friends of mine telling me he went out like a trooper, but inside my heart, I wish he went out like a sucker. And I remember the weeks that followed. You know, I wasn't allowed to go to the funeral. I could never say goodbye to him. But I kept remembering and saying, my brother had a life. He was going to make something out of his life. And I remember saying to myself, I'm going to live a little bit of my life for him. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to do it. And I figured one of the biggest problems that I had was my inability to read and write. So if I'm serving a sentence, you better come out of prison knowing how to read and write. And I made that commitment to education because I knew that if I could read and write, I could fill out a job application the next time around. And I don't have to depend on the dope on the streets to get me through anymore. And so I committed myself to that. Fast forward, I get out of prison. I have the harsh realities. I come back, A, to a community that doesn't want me because I was the worst out of the two brothers, supposedly. Okay? I come back, and the police department is on my butt because they thought I had an avenge agenda. They thought I wanted to kill the two police officers that killed my brother. I come back, BHA, which is the Boston Housing Authority, who holds my mother's Section 8 certificate, told her, if he spends one night in the house, we're going to take it away from you. So I'm homeless. I'm jumping couch to couch at friends' houses. Some of my friends are cool, some of my friends are still in the game. Everything was against me. My refuge came only because I kept saying to myself, live a little bit of your life for your brother. The aftermath of my brother's death, a little YMCA opened. And I started hanging at the YMCA. And that became my place of refuge. And it was within that Y that I found my calling to become a youth worker. Because what was happening, for the very first time in my life, some of the young men that were surrounding me were the hermanitos of the guys that I ran the streets with. And their brothers were locked, or their brothers were dead. And I had an opportunity to do something right for them that wasn't done for me. And I remember when I made that commitment to become a youth worker, I said to myself, I wrote it on a piece of paper, and I said, become the person that wasn't there for you. And that's my personal statement every day, to be the person that wasn't there for me. And I work hard to do that every day. What happened was 19 months after I get out of prison, the passion that I had to help my community got me the job and became the director of the center. I've never managed anything in my life. I never knew what a budget was. I still was struggling with my reading and writing. By no means am I proficient, okay? But I kept diving into the education. That became very important. That by the time I was 29, it took me 16 times to pass my GED. 16 times. You know how stupid I was? 16 times. And today, I don't even think I could pass HISET if they did it nowadays, okay? But it took me 16 times. But today, I stand with a master's degree, with an MBA, okay? My wife thinks I'm crazy. She's in the back, you know, because I want to pursue a PhD in organizational leadership. I think doctor would be a good title, all right? Okay? All right? So it's never over. And like I said, I've been blessed because the fact that I decided to invest in an education, invest myself in my community, I took my passion and allowed my passion to give me purpose. The great thing about it is I get a paycheck for it. So every day I go to work, it's like a vacation to me. You may see me in a suit, okay? But she'll tell you, I put on my J's, I put on my cap. I'm a New York Yankees fan living in Boston. Life is hard for me, but I do it, okay? All right, I do it. Now I'm blessed that because of the fact that I branded myself to be sort of a leader in our community, that the job that I have now is not a job I applied for. The mayor wanted me for 2 years. For 2 years, we've been playing a song and dance. He finally put me in a seat of power. And the only reason I took that seat of power is because I told him, I got to make sure that you're going to allow me to do some powerful things with it. And he has allowed me. Today, I run 36 facilities for the city of Boston. Okay? So I have 36 facilities, 17 pools, and I run one beach. And because I'm Puerto Rican, I'm putting some palm trees on it. Right? But I tell you, what I also do is that I'm the guy in charge of giving over 4,000 summer jobs to teenagers. I'm responsible for that. On top of it, I have 50 guys who are violent interrupters and street workers who manage 600 of the most violent gang members in the city of Boston, okay? And what I do is I go out and I bring them in like this and we talk about education. And we talk about the importance of second chances, because the only reason the mayor was able to convince me to take the job is that I have a mayor who 21 years ago, when I was coming out of prison, he was coming out of detox. So he believes in second chances. And I told him, if you're gonna give me the seat of power, it's about providing second chances. Each of you are sitting here today in the right place. This is the right moment for you to do something with your life, okay? Do not believe that your world was what I thought was my world, four blocks, okay? It isn't. There's a world out there waiting for you. The moment you believe that your world is four blocks, you're gonna end up in a cell block like me, or unfortunately, you're gonna end up 6 feet in the ground in a cement block. And that's where it comes down to. You have to become blockbusters. Break your mentality. Do something different. Achieve, man. You can do it. I'm not that much smarter than you. The only reason people call me a leader is because I'm out there all the time working tirelessly, but I don't see myself as a leader. I'm a humble follower of individuals that I inspire to lead. And that's the secret to my formula. And I know that my story ain't finished. I am very blessed that today I get to become the dad I never had. And I have 5 kids, all right? I thought 1 I was done, 2 I was through, 3 was gonna be no repeat, 4 was gonna be no more, now it's 5 till I die. The other day ago my friend said, well, put 6 in the mix. I think she'll kill me if you do that, all right? She'll kill me if you do that. But today, the good thing, the difference is that I'm able to be with my children every day. And I could care less about the title of commissioner, because the title that I care most is about being a father. But I understand that not only am I the father to my own children, but I'm also the father to a lot of fatherless children that I work with every day. So I'm hoping that, you know what I mean, that you get something out of the story, that you can understand that it's never too late. You know, I dropped out at 14. None of you have dropped out yet. I'm sure that you all know how to read and write. You already got a couple of steps ahead of me. The person that I am today could have been made a long time ago if I would have thought about different choices and decisions. Now, in closing, I'm going to leave letting you know that, you know, I'm not a perfect individual. I'm still gangbanging, I'm still dealing drugs, and I still carry a gun. Does that surprise you? Huh? It doesn't surprise you? Doesn't surprise you? I still carry a gun, and I'm still gangbanging and doing my stuff. No? Surprise? Well, if you think about it in this context, right, this is the way I look at it. I don't have to be from Holyoke to love y'all, all right? You're my people. You're me. Anytime somebody's going to tell you that you can't be something or you can't accomplish something or that college is not in your horizons or that you can't conquer, you know what I mean, anything that you want to conquer that's going to make your life better and make your community better, then trust me, the old gangbanger in me is going to come back out. I'm going to have your back. So I'm going to be there in that format as a gang member, having your back. You have a gang of people here, of adults who are caring and consistent. That's your gang. And we're all here to back you up and do what we have to do. Right? I still deal drugs, but the only thing I deal is truth about that life that I live. With the hope that you get addicted to it, and hopefully you take some part of the story, get high on it, and take it to another level. Don't become me. Become you while you still have time to do it, okay? And then lastly, the gun part, right? You're wondering how I carry a gun? Well, you know what's making me more dangerous because of the fact that I'm educated? Is that the mind is a gun, right? And any time that I have an obstacle in my way or I feel like I have a goal that I want to accomplish, I take aim, right? And the trigger is in my heart. And when I shoot to make the kill. Because I know I only got one shot. Every time I'm going to make a determined thought that if I'm going to go for that PhD, that's what I'm doing. That's what my gun is aimed at now. And I pull the trigger, I'm making the calls, I'm pulling in the relationship. I'm asking my wife, she's gonna have to give me time so that I can write this dissertation. All right? I'm doing everything that I have to do, but you have to think about it like that. Think about how you're gonna use your gun. Make sure that gun is lined up with the trigger inside your heart. And shoot for it and make some kills that are gonna benefit you for the rest of your life. All right? So thank you for having me this morning.
This relationship started a few weeks back, and I talked to Mary Ann. She's back there. We'll give her away, Mary Ann. Go ahead. I will tell you right now, we didn't know Will. We didn't know what he was going to come here and talk about. He's just a guy that came and wanted to share his story, all right? And he can speak from a lot of where you come, and it's real. We're going to continue to put people in front of you that care about you, and we'll be part of this gang, okay? Because we're going to hit him up again. We're going to get him here without the suit on, with his hat on, and his, maybe playing some basketball in the gym for co-ed intramural, something, out of this light. So it becomes real to you, so you can touch and feel him and know that it's real, because it is. We really appreciate Jay Anthony, you coming over here today and bringing Will. A couple questions from you. We had a couple questions for Reed. A couple questions from the audience. Could be teachers, adults alike. We got one way back there. Yes, Ms. Wax?
What did my mother think of me? I can tell you that when I came out of prison, my mother was a real mother. What I mean by that is that her friends had sons that went to prison and went back. So she didn't have a lot of high expectations. But I'll tell you a story that always chokes me up. When I graduated from Springfield College, okay, and I was given the class speech, my mother was the only one being hysterical in the back, screaming and, hallelujah, señor, and she was just going off, right? And I'm like, I'm giving the speech, and I'm like, oh, mommy, you're going off, And so I'm just giving this speech, and one of my college professors who spoke Spanish walked up to her and said, Doña Clara, everything all right? And she said, yeah, everything's okay. She said, you don't understand. My whole life, every time I've seen him stand at a podium, it's always been with his back towards me, because I was before a judge, or I was before DYS, or I was before something that was going to try to send me away. This was the first time she ever saw my face through a podium. Unfortunately, here's the reality about thug life. My mother spent 5 years after my brother's death visiting me in prison and visiting my brother at the cemetery on Sundays. So depression hit her hard. My mother's really young. She's only 63 years old and she has dementia. She can't speak no more because she had a neurocognitive disorder because of the dementia. So it was a little bit hard for me to get her out of depression because she was so alone for all those years. Don't ever think that your successes and your choices and your decisions just don't impact you. They impact everybody around you, and especially the woman who brought you into this world. She brought you into this world to live. So live. Live the life that she dreams for you. Make that dream come true. But I think that today, even though with everything that she goes through, she's extremely proud. She loves it when she sees me in the paper. She loves it when I'm on television. She brags to all her friends because she Facebooks. I don't know how she does it, but she Facebooks. All right? And she does it. And I'm glad that at least for a moment, she has the serenity now that she doesn't have to scream anymore because one of her sons have been shot or killed. She now screams because she can see one clearly his face from the former pope.
So I'm really grateful that you welcome my friend Will. And Will is one of the 100 stories about heroes around the world that are making a difference. And my book is in English and in Spanish. In English, it's Stone Soup for the World, Life-Changing Stories of Everyday Heroes. And in Spanish, it's Panamino para el Camino. And Edward James Olmos from Miami Vice and Battlestar Galactica, he's the one who asked me to get it in Spanish because he said we needed to have more Latino heroes and young people be able to read about folks like Will. So your principal and Alan all have a copy of the story, and so I'd like to invite all of you to read it, because you got much more. You know, when you write I had to distill that whole story down into, what, I don't know, a couple thousand words. When you write an essay, you'll know, it's tough, huh, to write that story. But it's real, and you can tell people, hey, I met this guy once. And you can be that same person, and that's what the book is about. So if you like his story, maybe you'll read the one about Gandhi or Martin Luther King or Cesar Chavez, Eleanor Roosevelt, Mother Teresa, Nelson Mandela, because there's lots of good people on the planet, and all of you have that little spark of light. We need to spread that around. So thank you.
Yeah, so I gotta get going because I'm visiting some other places, and I have to get back to Boston and Florida to do an event that I'm doing at City Hall, and then I got a Latinos for Hillary thing, right? How many of you guys can vote? How many who's in it? You better vote, all right? I'm serious. But look, I'm connected with J. Anthony, I'm connected with Marianne. I don't have a problem coming back and visiting. I got family here in Holyoke, so it doesn't mean that I don't frequent out here every once in a while. And then we can really kind of talk a little bit more, right? And if you're ever in Boston, just let me know, okay? Thank you.